The phases of tooth movement. Burstone categorizes the stages of tooth movement into the initial phase, the lag phase, and the post-lag phase. Initial phase, there is a very rapid tooth movement over a short distance. After this, the tooth movement then stops. It represents the tooth displacement in the periodontal membrane space. It's indicative of the bending of the alveolar bone. Both light and heavy forces can displace the tooth, and 0.4 to 0.9 millimeter of tooth movement can occur in a week's time. Next is the lag phase, where little to no tooth movement occurs. There is formation of the hyaluronized tissue in the periodontal ligament, and the duration of the lag phase depends on the amount of force used to move the tooth. For example, as said earlier, light forces produce smaller areas of hyaluronization. There will be larger areas of hyaluronization if heavy forces are used. This period lasts for about 2 to 3 weeks, or sometimes can even extend up to 10 weeks. The post-lag phase, the tooth movement progresses rapidly as the high alanized zone is removed and bone resorption occurs. The osteoclasts are found over a larger surface area, so there is a direct resorption of bony surface facing the periodontal ligament. This is the graph depicting the phases of tooth movement, where in the initial phase, we can see that there's a rapid tooth movement, and after covering a certain distance, it just stops. In the lag phase, there's no tooth movement that can be appreciated. And during the post-lag phase, there is again increment in the tooth movement. Next is the theories of tooth movement. Number one, the pressure tension theory by Suarez. Two, the fluid dynamic theory, or the blood flow theory by Bain. And the last one, the bone bending and the piezoelectric theories of the tooth movement. Beginning from the pressure tension theory, in the year 1911, Oppenheim was the first person to study tissue changes in the bone relating to the orthodontic tooth movement. According to this theory, when orthodontic force is applied to the tooth, two areas can be seen. One is the area of pressure and other is the area of tension. Areas of pressure are seen in the direction of tooth movement, where because of the pressure applied, there is the disorganization of the periodontal ligament. There is diminution of the fiber production, hence there is decreased cell replication, there is vascular constriction, all leading to bone resorption. Whereas in the areas of tension, there is a stimulation produced by the stretching of the periodontal ligament fiber bundle. So there's increased cell replication. Hence, this tension that occurs opposite to the tooth movement over here, bone deposition occurs. Over the in the pressure tension theory, there are two terminologies that we have to get familiar with, which are the frontal bone resorption and the undermining bone resorption, as already discussed earlier. Next is the fluid dynamic theory. Its main gist is that when we apply forces of longer duration, the interstitial fluid, they get squeezed out. Hence, there is vascular stenosis, decreased oxygen level, and there will be changes in the chemical environment that would favor the orthodontic tooth movement. Now, moving on line by line. In the fluid dynamic theory, what it says is that the tooth movement occurs because of changes in the fluid dynamics in the periodontal ligament. The periodontal space that is located between the two hard tissues, the tooth and the alveolar bone, which is and the space, it's a confined space where the input and the output of the fluid is quite limited. It contains the fluid system composed of the interstitial fluid, the cellular elements, the ground substance, the periodontal fibers, and so on. Such contents create a unique hydrodynamic condition resembling a hydraulic mechanism and a shock absorber. And when the force is removed, the fluid is refilled by diffusion from the capillary walls, and there is recirculation of the interstitial fluid. There is an effect known as the squeeze film effect by Bain, according to which when we apply the orthodontic forces, which are of greater magnitude and direction, the interstitial fluid in the periodontal space will get squeezed out. They will move towards the apex and the cervical margins, and hence there is decreased tooth movement. When the orthodontic force is applied, there is compression of the periodontal ligament. The blood vessels of the periodontal ligament get trapped between the between the principal fibers. This will cause the stenosis. The vessel above the stenosis then balloons to form an aneurysm. The formation of these aneurysms and the vascular stenosis causes the blood gases to escape into the interstitial fluid, and hence it will create a favorable local environment for the bone resorption, which will make the tooth movement possible. The last theory is the bone bending and the piezoelectric theories. Farrar in the year 1876 was the first person to note the deformation or bending of the interseptal alveolar walls. Now, before jumping into this theory, let's know what this piezoelectricity means. It means a phenomenon that is observed in many crystalline materials where the deformation of crystal structure produces a flow of electric current, which is a result of displacement of electrons from one part of crystal lattice to the other. Associating this phenomenon with us, with especially in the context of bone, a small electric current is generated when the bone is mechanically deformed. Some of the possible sources of electric current include the collagen, which exists in its crystalline form in our body, and which when degenerated can be a potential source for the piezoelectricity. The hydroxyapatite, which also exists in its crystalline form, can also produce the electric signals if deformed. The same goes for collagen hydroxyapatite interface and this mucopolysaccharide. Although not crystalline in nature, it makes up a fraction of the ground substance, and this mucopolysaccharide, which if deformed can also produce the piezoelectricity. Further electric effect is not observed if the crystal structure is stable. Such stability will be there as long as the force is maintained and the crystals return to their original shape when the force is released. So a reverse flow of electrons is observed. This rhythmic activity produces a constant interplay of the electric signals. Piezoelectric signals have two unusual characteristics. Number one, the quick decay rate, which means that when we apply the force, then the piezoelectric signals will be released, which will just quickly fade away to zero, even though the force will be maintained. Next is, when the force is released, the electron flow in the opposite direction is seen. So on the application of force, there will be areas of concavity and the areas of convexity. In the areas of concavity, there will be negative charges to denote the bone deposition. And in the areas of convexity, there will be positive charges and there will be bone resorption. So from this figure, we can say that when the force is applied on the tooth, the adjacent alveolar bone bends. This deformation causes the bone to get electrically charged to exhibit this phenomenon known as the piezoelectricity that will either be of the positive charge or the negative charge. If there is negative charge, then it denotes the bone deposition, and if positive, the bone resorption.
Thank you for watching this video. If you found this video is helpful, please don't forget to like, subscribe and share our channel. If you have any feedback, please leave it on comment box. We'll try to make better videos in next videos and next chapters. Thank you.